Father wants you to have the inheritance of the things of the kingdom of God. He wants you to enjoy Him. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
He wants you to possess Him. Hallelujah. It's like Joseph. He said, you just tell me whatever it was you dreamed. I'll tell you what it means because I possess God. I have an inheritance. He knew. He had a realm of relationship that produced within him a faith that he was on God's side, that God was on his side, that no secrets would be hidden from him. Just tell me what you dreamed. I'll tell you what it means. Tell me what's going on. I'll bring to you the answer and bring to you the remedy. Why can I say that? I possess God. He is in me. The greater one is with me. The resource of all those things that bring salvation and deliverance to men occupy my life. This is a realm called faith that is ultimately revealed for the relationship, not because you want to, you hope to, you desire to, but because you've received what it is he's given. You know, and as we were talking to you before, a measure of faith that has allowed there to be an outworking of your life, of God in your life, which first and foremost, people, it really needs to be expressed through this relationship and fellowship. This morning, you know, their service was just built off of tongues, interpretation of tongues. My tongue is a pen of a ready writer. My tongue is his quill. The Spirit is the ink. He writes the pages. Write the pages of your will. Write the pages of your life. Write the pages of your love. Written on my heart, expressed on my face. And people, God's looking for some folks where the light might be able to shine, his glory and presence might be made manifest to your life, where a relationship captivates you. You're not under obligation to seek God anymore. You've got this passion going on the inside of you. You've got this walk taking place within you. You've got a communion and a companionship. Come on, people. Yes. Sometimes I feel like I'm talking to the wall. Come on now. Come on now. I'm telling you right now, write it down in your little notebook. God wants you to be very different than what you are right now.
Amen.
He wants you to have a greater expression of that which meant that measure of faith that he gave you. He wants you to begin to take that in the place that he gave it to you to have the fellowship and the relationship. Hallelujah. Come on now. You don't need to be offended by it. It's an opportunity that says, oh, okay, I am. She does. I want that.
Yeah.
You mean he's putting pressure on me to have all what he's got? Yeah.
Hallelujah.
He puts the pressure on you to have excessive joy, to have excessive love, to have the ability, the resource, the provision, the answer. Hallelujah. Spirit of the Lord's here. God the Holy Ghost is here. He's with me. He's in me. Father wants you to know he's with you. And he's in you. Father wants you to have that day where you know that the Father is in him and he's in you. That you possess God. Ha! 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 Where there's a temple. Hallelujah. A temple. A temple of the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. A temple. A temple. You know, I'm doing a model right now of Ezekiel's third, Ezekiel's temple. It's called the third temple. And, you know, it's hundreds of pieces. And finally, the other day, I put the crown on top of the tabernacle. And it is the most beautiful piece on the whole board. It's all wood. It's a wood three-dimensional model. And I put the golden crown. You know, when I first got it built, it was kind of dark. It looked kind of spooky. But then I started putting the gold windows in. Then I started putting the gold trim in. Then I put the gold entryway in. Huh? Then I put, and now it's starting to light up. This ain't looking like no spooky house no more. And then this crown, it's a crown of gold. It's been a lot of time with this crown of gold. And I set the crown of gold upon on the temple. My goodness gracious. If this goes on too much, you're going to have to take her out. You know, and just help her work through whatever it is that's going on. Keep her in. If she has to go out, just keep her in. But make sure that it's painful. Okay? If she has to go up, make sure it's painful. Pinch something. You know? I mean, make sure that it isn't a reward. Don't go take her out and feed her, you know, her favorite food. You know, because you're gonna get the wrong results like that. Okay? You know, the Lord wants to correct us, He wants to chasten us, He wants to discipline us and help us so we'll make right choices, so we'll have the right behavior. Because I'm telling you right now, you're the temple of the Lord, you got yourself a crown on you. You're not a little spooky house. Ah, you got the gold trim. You've been all fitted out. I'm telling you. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. The Lord wants you to have prayer that causes a wind to fill whatever place you're in. Yes. He wants you to have an expression of the language of the Spirit, cause chill bumps go up and down people's back. Cause their hairs stand up on the back of their neck. What was that? That is amazing. What was that? Hallelujah. Don't you want the expressions of heaven to be revealed through your life? God's got a place He built, a tabernacle that He delights to dwell in. It's your life, it's your being. You got to know these things so you can get excited about them. It's got to quit second guessing God. Quit wondering how it's going to work out. Maybe it's there. Maybe it's going to take place. It's time for you to start seeking the Lord like He's seeking you. Yeah. Father's seeking somebody to worship. Somebody said, how do I get in this? Worship. A measure of faith was given to you for a relationship with Him. A oneness relationship, a unique relationship. So you can dwell in that place and live in that realm till it becomes something that is so powerful in the expression of confidence and boldness and certainty. He's here. Hallelujah. And I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. Nothing is impossible for me. It's my God who upholdeth me and makes my way perfect. It is the Lord who is on my side, who stands with me, my help in time of trouble. He's before me and behind me. Hallelujah. He is my shield and my buckler and my exceeding great reward. Hallelujah. Amande risate ya. You know, if your tongue is a pen of a ready writer, and your tongue truly is a quill, and the Spirit is the ink, you're going to begin by start declaring the things which God has said in His Word. A one yeah, three nods of the head, and a bunch of people just understood. Come on then, people. Come on now, sit. Don't sit there and look at me like that, because some of you have been sitting there looking at me like that for way too long, and it's not me you're looking at, it's the Father. It's His Father, because it's the Father that addresses you. Yes. It's Christ Jesus that addresses you. Yes. This is true. And He's wanting some fruit from you. He's wanting some response from you. And all that's going on is a fear that holds you in a prison of bondage that keeps you from moving out. Any confidence that says, tell me the dream, I'll tell you what it means. What's going on? Just give me 10 seconds and I'll give you a word of knowledge. Come over here. We'll see you get healed. See you get a miracle. Come right here. Right. Listen, I'm going to just hang on for a second. I'm going to prophesy here just a second. Hallelujah. I'm going to give you some tongues and then the interpretation of the tongues. Hallelujah. Because I possess the realms of heaven. I possess the Almighty God, the spokesman. I possess the one who created the heaven, the earth. He tabernacles and dwells in me. He can't speak through me. I can't be confident that He's going to do the sign and the wonder and the miracle through me. It's all because we haven't stepped in to the relationship and allowed that to become developed to where that this glory of walking it out with Him is more important to us than anything else. And so, therefore, we're trapped in the fear of our own human ability. It's a scary place, isn't it? Because in that own human ability, you're going to open your mouth and the preacher's going to say, shh. And you're going to wonder, why is it you have to shh every time? He's waiting for the Holy Ghost to start moving through you. Huh? He's waiting for the sound of heaven. Huh? Hallelujah. It is starting this year for you tonight. You know, scripture say, say the word of God.
The word of God
is my inspiration. Hallelujah. This is God's word to you tonight. I know that's hard for you to believe. I know that some of you just cannot even possibly imagine that this is God's word for you tonight. For you've sit and listened so long without there being a laying hold of that which his word is declared, allowing it to mix, be mixed with faith and then moving in it. And there being faithful with it to where that no matter what comes out against you, you still just as confident in the storm and in the terrible circumstance and the opposing situation as you would be as the word goes forth tonight here in this place of safety. Here's what he says in Genesis chapter 15, verse 1. He said this to Abram or to Abraham, but he says it to you. Believe me, there's nothing that happens, nothing that is not a manifestation of what is going on in your life. You believe me, if you'll begin to discern the thing, the decisions you make, if you begin to discern the circumstances and situation around your life and just quit making it coincidence, just so happenstance, suddenly you're going to be able to start seeing and hearing this with spirit knowledge, the reality of what you're up against, what's going on in your life, and what's going on in other people's lives. There is so much to see in the realms of the spirit, and people walk around blind. They've been equipped to discern things in the natural and make decisions. If they're a mechanic, to make a decision about what's wrong with the automobile. If they're a lawyer, to make decisions about how to you know, prosecute the case. A doctor, how to make decisions about the physical health, but they have no discernment concerning the multitudes of the manifestation of the Spirit of the living God that is revealing over and again continually what's really taking place, where the issues really are, where the heart of the Father is. Oh, would you let God begin to write the pages of His will in your life tonight? Would you let God begin to write the pages? Let God write the pages of His will in your life tonight. Let God write the pages of His life in your life tonight. Let God write the pages of His love in your life tonight, in your heart and the expression of your face. Why? Because your tongue is going to begin to be have the tongue of the learned, and you're going to express what God says in His word. You're going to begin to declare what God says and what He's declared concerning you. So all your opinions, which amount to nothing. Men might be oppressed with your opinions, but I'm going to tell you right now, God's distressed with them. God's distressed with them. You know, when He said, if a man speaks anything, He just tells us we're supposed to speak as the oracles of God. Every word that comes out of our mouth is supposed to be as an offering, a sacrifice. It's supposed to be as we're salted with salt. Hallelujah. God wants us to begin to express His word and declare those things that belong to what He says, rather than to be acting as those who have no light in them. Because those who do not speak after this word is because they have no light in them. They've never come into revelation of this relationship, the knowledge of God. Joseph had the knowledge of God. That's why he was able, in the most unlikely circumstance, to believe God after having been thrown in the pit, you know, now thrown in the prison. And now he's still just as confident in God as he ever was. Come on now. Come on now. That's faithfulness with the faith that is given. That is a walk with God. That is trust with God. That he didn't have a walk compared to what Enoch had, because God was able to take him and exalt him to the highest place in the kingdoms of the earth at the day and time that he lived in. Well, Enoch, he got translated to the highest place of all. He got exalted to the throne room of God. He's been standing there beholding the glory of Father for all this period of time. I'm jealous. I'm like, what about me? What about me? I walked into a place tonight, the Lord making me to know I'm with you. I'm in you, I'm with you. Speak all these words. Hallelujah. Father's got something that He wants to bring forth to me. You got some ideas about what you think you want for your life and what you think it ought to look like. I promise you, it has nothing to do with what God wants. You're going to have to get your heart and your head hooked up with what Father said but in the context of relationship. Otherwise, it's a pretext and not a context. It's just ideas. Ah, to begin to see these things as a living reality where you can begin to function and move in what God described through the life of his only begotten son, Jesus, which Paul caught it and he ran with it and declared to the church, guys, this is what God wants to do with your life. This is what it looks like. He wants the demonstration of the Holy Ghost and power, signs and wonders and miracles. God wants signs and wonders and miracles in your life tonight. Yeah. And the greatest sign and wonder and miracle that I know of is to be able to interact with him and love him and give to him that which he's seeking for, to begin to move in the Holy Ghost with worship, with love, with that's coming out of your heart, that's coming out of your being, that's coming out of your mind, that is a captivating wellspring springing up, a flow of divine power through your life that takes you into an emotional state that is just absolutely divine. You can't make up for it with your hop, 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 do a hop. You can't make up for it with the dance. You can't make up for it with the movements of your body. It's got to come forth from the depths of your heart. People try to make up for their lack of heart with this. No, no, no. Let the dance be an expression of the heart. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. But don't try to make up for the heart, lack of the heart. Lack of the flow. Somebody said, well, listen, what do I do? I'm in this state. You're talking about me. What do? Start worshiping. Quit doing what you've been doing and start worshiping. Start getting excited about him. Quit saying, oh, Lord, I want to love you, and start saying, Lord, I love you. Quit saying, oh, God, I want to be this, and say, thank you, Father, that you made me this. Ha, ha, ha. Quit saying like it's all going to be in the future and just start calling it now. Start praising them that it's a now thing. Thank you now. Come on, man. Get just a little bit excited. Yeah. Just get just a little excited about it. Sometimes I think people are like, they act like I'm trying to hand out like spoonfuls of dirt. Even we want to fill you up with the good things. Ah, my mind is laying across the day. Hallelujah. 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 Listen, some of you surfers, let me just tell you right now what it's kind of like, okay? It's kind of like we've been watching you pedal out for 20 years and you still can't float on your board. And for 20 years, you haven't caught a wave. You just still basically, you're dog paddling. You're dog paddling and your nose is like 4 foot up in the air. You're on the back end of the thing and you're off balance and you're constantly falling off the thing. 20 years later. 20 years later, you're sitting there. The board's not planed out. It's straight up and down and you think you're going to catch a wave. And you're going, what? It's not, and what I'm talking about, what I'm talking about is easier than that. It's easier than that. It's easier than that. What I'm talking about, it's easier than that. This is something God wants to do. You're going to have to quit doing so God can do. Somebody said, how do I do that? Worship him. Till you raptured and you'll see how you'll make a transition. You'll get shut down. God get, you know, fired up on the inside of you, and you recognize that you're not alone. You begin to understand the greater one who's on the inside of you. You begin to understand the overcoming power of the Spirit of the Lord and the very life of Jesus Christ that is in you. Hallelujah. You begin to understand a wellspring springing, the very life of God, the life, the person. Jesus Christ is described to be in 1 John as the eternal life. When you have him, you have eternal life. If you do not have him, if you do not possess him, you do not have life. You do not have life. You do not have eternal life, the very life of God. I'm telling you. You possess God if you've been born again. And God possesses you. You're in him and he's in you. You're his purchased possession. You belong to him. You may not feel like you belong to him, but you do. not be able to interact with you much like that, but he's still protecting you. And when he can get a word through edgewise, he does, and he draws you, and he gets you here in the building. The Lord looks at Abraham and says to him, after these things, the word of the Lord came to Abraham in a vision, and the Lord said, fear not. Hear me. Fear not. It's like the word of the Lord came to Annalyn here a few minutes ago. She said, so many people, they're in the prison of fear. They're just trapped by fear. They can move forward if they weren't afraid. The spirit of fear captivates them. Intimidation, all these realms, there's various discouragements around the fear. There's so many descriptions to fear. God says over 360 times, fear not. He says to Jairus, I'm the way to work a miracle for Jairus. Because Jairus said, my daughter is home. She's sick. She's dying. Come and lay your hands on her and heal her. Jesus said, I'll go with you. On the way, one of the servants came and said, don't trouble the master. Your daughter's dead. First thing Jesus says, fear not. Fear not. God possesses you. He's given you more anointing than Enoch. What he's given you, the possibility of it. He's given you the privilege of having a greater anointing in your life than Joseph. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. It's Father's goodwill to give us everything that belongs to the Holy Ghost and everything that belongs to the kingdom. But he'll start you off with a measure of faith. And he doesn't put any dictates on how fast that measure can grow into all fullness of faith. Huh? Because Stephen was full of faith and he got there in a very short time. Because he was all in. He wasn't sitting around, going eeny, meeny, miny, mo. I've got so many choices to go. I got so many possibilities and opportunities of things that I could do with my life. I wonder if I want all that God has for me. That's why you see so many people in Asia and different parts of the world where they don't have any choices. And they step right over in to a greater dimension of the power and the anointing of the Holy Ghost, almost like overnight. Because they're not sitting around picking door number one, door number two, or door number three. Pick a door and win a prize, like people in the West are. Give me door number one. No. I'm thinking. Door number three. No, wait. I think door number, no. Maybe one. What? Two, no. No, let me take some more. The Lord is looking at you tonight, and he says to you and to me, he says, I am your shield. I am your suzerain. I am your benefactor. I'm the one that stands as your bodyguard. I'm your shield. I'm your shield bearer. Huh? The king had a shield bearer. The mighty men had a shield bearer, an extra shield. They would protect them because they were very important. Huh? He said, I'm going to stand there and be your shield bearer. Huh? I'll be your... And suzerain, this particular Hebrew word, megen, goes beyond that. It goes beyond that. Prorosate. Oh, if I could just captivate you for a minute so you could believe and the word would be mixed with faith and those who hear tonight, all of a sudden you would stand up and you would begin to put the armies of the aliens to flight. You'd quench the violence of fire. All of a sudden you would step into the healing that you need for your body. You would step into the authority that God has given to us by his spirit. You would quit playing patty games with your religious understanding of the scriptures. Spiritual patty cake games with all the little people that you come along and you want to just talk about scripture. You go, okay, put your hands up. Let's talk about scripture. Patty cake, bake as well as a man. Because that's about what it looks like. It's what it looks like. It's childish games with the things of the spirit. That's why Paul said, I'm not interested really in all the things you guys are saying over there. I'm coming to you and all I want to see is your power. I don't want to hear a single word come out of your mouth. I want to get there and I want to look at the anointing. I want to look at the display of the power of God through your life. I want to see some miracles, signs and wonders and some authority. And if I don't see that, I'm coming to you. And I'm coming with some power. And we're going power to power. Because he's speaking out of the heart of Father. Speaking out of the heart of God. We want to go and represent God. And many of God's people are just like Moses, who doing it all after their own human ability and the arm of flesh. Huh? They killed the Egyptian. They're trying to break up the argument among the brethren, you know, spread the good news. They've never stood before the fire. Come on, people, it's time tonight because the burning bush is here. The same fire. I know it is just like, wow, it may be not, but I tell you absolutely so. The same fire that was in the bush is here right now. The same fire that was in the cloud is here right now. Same fire God he's promised. You might say, well, I just don't think you're that anointed. It is regardless of who I am, God himself is doing what he has declared he would do. It's really very little to do with men other than him to believe. That's it. Only believe. The Lord says, do you believe? He'll always ask, do you believe? He'll say, according to your faith, according to what you believe. What do you want me to do for you? Do you know who I am? Will you recognize who I am? If you recognize who I am, the gift of God that I have for you, watch out. It's going to get real good in here. Hallelujah. You start doing that. You start doing that. You start getting happy about the Word of God, and something's going to change in your life. Some of you are going to have to go home and watch a movie tonight. It's true. That's where basically where some folks, that's the only place they really need to get any comfort. But when you begin to get excited about Jesus. Oh, when you begin to get excited about the Word of God. Oh, that means faith has just got hooked up with the Word. Hallelujah. Something supernatural just happened. Oh, yeah. And it's not just excitement for the sake of excitement. It's Holy Ghost emotion. God seeking people to have Holy Ghost emotion going on in their life. To begin to worship Him by the Holy Ghost. Come tell me, He's an amazing inspirer. I mean, when God the Holy Spirit sets down into our spirit. Think about it. When God the Holy Spirit sets down into our spirit. Whoa. And you begin to understand that your spirit is that which moves your emotions and your passions and your appetite. It's that which motivates you, inspires you. It's that which wakes you up. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Somebody said, I really want that. Worship. Amen. Quit complaining. Amen. Quit fussing. Amen. Quit fighting. Amen. Quit looking to other things to fulfill you. Come on. Oh, my. I've just seen the simplest faith. I've just always been captivated by the simplest faith that takes hold of God. When people come off the streets, as it were, been raised in the hood, give their life to Jesus, and within a week, they're functioning in some manifestation of the gifts of the Spirit because they simply took with childlike acceptance that God possesses them, that they've got God, that God's with them and God's in them. And my, look at what happens. And so many people have said it, that most of God's people, the most effective dimension and time of their life is the first 6 months of salvation. That's just so sad. And then they get bored with the relationship. And then everything's back to normal. It's just a religious normal now. Huh? Before they used to be exciting. When they were sinners, now they're just a wet Christian, wet blanket. You know what I'm saying? No, I don't know. Well, just pretend you know for a minute. Huh? Oh, Father wants to make you a more exciting person. Hallelujah. Than you've ever been in your life. I mean, the Lord wants to start doing stuff in your heart in such a way. You're driving down the road now with your head hanging out the window. Jesus saves! Man, the power of God's here! Holy Ghost is falling on you right now! Come on, man. Come on now. Excitement. Like, this is real. This is real. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Lord Jesus. You so go to 1 John in chapter 5, verse 12. You know, whew, my God. My goodness. I want you to get this tonight. I'm going to just preach. I'm going to keep giving you the word until an event happens.
Amen.
Suddenly you can balance on the board. Suddenly you don't look like a goof no more. Spiritual goof. We got other words, but I'm leaving them. I don't want to provoke you too much. I'm just trying to entreat you, trying to draw you in. Because you can have this. Begins with worship. Begins with extravagant praise and thanksgiving, even when things are bad, because you're just happy with the relationship. Wow, this is good. I don't yield myself to sorrow and sadness. Uh-uh. No. That's for the realms of darkness. That's for the lost. Huh? I run over to the joy. Get over to the joy real quickly. Hallelujah. Emergency tongues, whatever you need. Call somebody up who can pray the prayer of faith. But whatever you do, quit yielding to that stuff because it's going to make a mess out of you. A goof. A spiritual goof. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Are you ready? I'm preaching these things until you believe them. Because see, God's word produces faith. I've watched people that don't know anything about God. People even that were agnostic said there is no God. And I just declare the word of God to them. And I've watched that word of God go into them and it just completely disarm them and change them. Hallelujah. So I'm certain that that same word is going to do something for you tonight. I know it might seem a little bit harder, but I'm going to tell you right now, I see faith. I see it the way it's supposed to be. I see what God is going to do with you. You know, I mean, come on, you can make it harder. You can make it easy. You can bless me or you can just basically make it a gift and me, a hard job to do. This can happen the next couple of weeks or we can do it for the next 20 years. I'm going to stay with you. Yeah. I'm going to go run and find some other folks too, but I'm going to stay with you. Oh my gosh, I tell you. Some of you, I'm going to start pushing you over. I'll tell you right now. I was in a meeting one night, not too long ago, I can't remember where it was, and the person was getting all uppity, and they're standing there all uppity, you know. And there were some things going on, and I walked over and I tripped them. I put my leg behind them and I pushed them over. I said, now. And the power of God hit them too. As soon as they hit the ground, boom. They weren't just saying, hey, I think he pushed me over. Everybody saw me. I put my leg behind them and I threw them to the ground. Big old guy. You know, we might have had a fight on our hands or something if the power of God hadn't hit him before he hit the ground. The breakthrough, what God will do to try to break through your opposition. I got a text this morning of a person who had cancer in a place we prayed for him up in Iowa. He had cancer. His bag outside of his head. He opened up his shirt, showed me this. His whole intestines was outside of his body in a bag from colon cancer, which is a terrible cancer when it gets in its advanced stages. And he said in the meeting, yawning. There's a couple of times I was about ready to jump over there and give him a headlock in the Holy Ghost. I'm telling you right, a real one though. A real one, I tell you. What are you doing in this place? There's a couple of times I felt like it. And the Lord said, no, shh. And then laid down on the floor, started doing a few exercises. I kid you not. It's true as in baby. I'm not exaggerating at all. It was nuts. I'm like, what's this guy doing in this place? But I praise God, I just got this ball of fire around me. I'm protected. I'm just flowing in the Holy Ghost. I don't care what he's doing. I do feel like a couple of times getting a hold of him, but the Lord says no. And I'm under the strength of the Lord. I'm going to do what I'm going to do whatever he says. If he tells me to go trip somebody, I'm going to trip him. Yeah. Hallelujah. If he tells me to kiss him, I'm going to kiss him. Because my spirit's united with his spirit. I'm good. I can trust this. I can trust that whatever I'm feeling is God, because I'm not allowing any unholy feelings. Whatever I'm feeling, this is God. Whatever I'm thinking, I'm getting a word of knowledge right now, because my mind's hooked up with his mind. I know what's going on. People might sit there. I've had situations where I'm just reading it right one thing after another. This is what's going on in your life. This is what's going on in your life. This is what. And somebody's sitting there shaking their head. No, that's not you. No, that's not true. I'm going, oh, yes, it is true. Oh, yes, it is true. Oh, no, that's not you. You're completely wrong. Oh, I am completely right. And then power of God hit them and they bust into tears. But if I would have gotten to listen to what they had to say, I've gone, oops, I missed it. And then they would have won the contest. I know more and I'm more certain about who I know and who's in me. I'm more certain about and more confident of my God than they are of themselves. Yes. Come on, people. Yes. Get big. Yes. You know, get big with God. I was so blessed to hear what Bethany was telling me, where you guys teamed up and prayed for somebody in the classroom with a hurt knee, injured knee. Praise God, and he got healed. Come on. Yes. Come on. Yes. Just knowing. We're going to do this thing. Invite the principal in if you want, whatever. You need something. Walk around and say, interview people. You sick? You need any prayer? You hurting? You in pain? You tormented? You afraid? Got any fear? You got to tell you right now, people, you walk into somebody and say, hey, is there any fear going on in your life? You got a word of knowledge for everybody. Are you listening to me?
Yes.
Huh? You got a word of knowledge for everybody. Yes. You ask anybody and say, you got fear going on in your life? If they tell you no, they lying. Now, if they say no, it's your opportunity to say, but yeah, how about the other night when you were laying in bed and you were thinking this? Right. Now they're going to go. Yeah. They brought the guy, you know, he came up with his wife. His wife's crying the whole time, right? Everybody's out there. I prayed for everybody. I didn't want to pray for the guy. Yawning, exercises. I prayed for everybody in the house, some people twice. I went back to them. Huh? I walk over towards them. They thought I was going to pray for them. And his wife's getting all excited. I'd pass by him, go pray for somebody on the other side of him. Huh? Then he walked back this other way. They're getting like, oh, I'm going to come pray for him. No, and I go back all the way to the other end. Pray for somebody who hadn't hit the ground yet. Because if you'll stay around, you'll hit the ground. Sometimes I got to go on the fourth or fifth time. Hallelujah. That's true. It's true. You get people being in Holy Ghost meetings who are hungry and thirsty, they'll just easily receive the anointing, things of the anointing, and go with it. Praise God for that. People come desperate, power of God hit them. But a lot of people, they're just stiff as a rail. Stiff as a railway rail. Just stay. You know, I love three-night meetings. I'm going to have to start doing some three-night meetings around here. God can get a lot done 3 nights. 3 days. Hallelujah. So finally, I don't remember what it was. Somebody said to me, I think, would you please come pray for him? And as soon as they did, the anointing hit me. I went over there and I read the guy the riot act. I mean, I just right, left, and center. This is who you are. This is what you're doing. Who do you think you are? Huh? Hallelujah. I was Holy Ghost. I was just Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. He said, I'm a fighter. I said, that's a big part of your problem. He didn't learn how to get broken before God. Amen, right? It's true. Because the Holy Ghost talking to him. I said, now what are you going to do with your healing? And I know some people from Iowa watching me right now. They were in the meeting. I said, what are you going to do with your healing? He sat there and looked at me. I don't remember what he said, but I just remember the anointing come upon me. Pray for him. Be healed now in the name of Jesus. You foul spirit of cancer, disease, I curse you now and die in Jesus' name. And left it. You know, we got a text this morning, no cancer, completely healed. You know, it's wonderful. It's power of God's presence to do it. I'm confident of it. I'm confident of it. I'm confident of what he's going to do through me. I don't really know what he's going to do through you. But I know what he's going to do through me. Because I have no power over your will. God does not exercise power over you. You choose who you're going to follow and who you're going to imitate. You choose what you're going to believe and what you're going to connect with. You choose it. I just chose God. I chose an inheritance. I chose to be possessed of God. To have God for a possession. God is my possession. You know, over and over again, the prophets constantly said to the children of Israel, if you just yield to the Lord in obedience and submission to Him, then you will step into your inheritance. And they give, and you know, and they describe all the beauty and all the splendor of the inheritance. Over and over again, he would say it. And their inheritance was the land flowing with milk and honey. I mean, when you hear what, you know, of course, what the Lord is presenting to Abraham is he's saying, I'm your inheritance. I'm your shield. I'm your exceeding great reward. In other words, he's saying, I'm your prize. He said, I'm your prize. Yeah. And there's that response. There's that response. People are going, you've got to be kidding me, you. Whoa. This is better than door number one, door number two, or door number three. Even if I could have it all three of them. I got you. I got you. I got you. Woo! That's how I stay healthy.
Hallelujah.
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 Hallelujah. You know, it is a beautiful thing. You start moving in faith. Faith starts beginning to be developed in your life. You start seeing the exploits of faith in your life. And then God whispers to you and says, you ain't seen nothing yet. That was just practice. You ain't seen nothing yet because that was still mixed with you. I'm about to do some stuff on your behalf that's all me. No, I had the Lord tell me that yesterday. I'm about to do some stuff on your behalf that's all me. I'm going to tell you right now, worship's going to start. Where's it going to start? Praise going to come now. Oh, Papa, you got to be kidding me. I already had the grand prize. Oh, what God is to us and for us. You know, John opens the first epistle with eternal life. And he closes it with eternal life. And he talks about eternal life in between. First words or opening words really are about eternal life. Closing words, eternal life. He said the life was manifested and we've seen and bear witness that eternal life which was with the Father. And he said, he makes it very clear in John chapter 1 of the gospel that here is the life, and the life is the light of man that lights up every man that comes into the world. This is the life, him. And he, so he says in verse 12 of 1 John chapter 5, he says, he who hath the Son, that literally is to possess him. It literally is theologically to be indwelt. It is a, you know, theological terms, they pick up terms sometimes and phrases that just doesn't really seem like good English, but it's just a theological phrase. It is the theological phrase that everybody agrees to be indwelt by God. That's what 1 John 5:12 means. I don't care if it's a Presbyterian theologian or if it's a Roman Catholic theologian or who it is. They say, this is the verse of being indwelt. He who has the Son have life, and that life is eternal life. That life is the life of God. That life is the life that he described in John chapter 14. He says, if you'll just agree with me, if you'll just agree with me, if you'll just hook up with me, if you'll just say what I say, if my word will be in your mouth, if you'll just say what I say, if you'll just move in it, you'll have it. If you'll just do this, you can have this. He tells us, if you just agree with me, if you just obey me, if you just go with me in this thing, if you just let me fill you with my love, which produces obedience. I got the spirit of obedience. Hallelujah. I once had the spirit of disobedience. That thing been cast out. Praise God. I got the spirit of obedience. If you just agree with me, if you just yield to me, he says, I will come and manifest myself, and my Father and I will come and I'll make our abode with you. And you heard me just a few minutes ago quote that verse of scripture. I've just quoted verse 23, but I quoted that verse of scripture in John 14, 20, where the Lord said, in that day, you shall know that the Father is in me and that I am in you. And somebody said, oh, in that day, the day of the coming of the Lord, that eschatological event. No, it's not an eschatological event in the future. It is the event of when the Holy Spirit comes into your life. So many people have not really had that day. They said they had Pentecost, but Pentecost is supposed to produce that day where you understand that you are possessed by God. That God is your possession. He's yours. You have him. He that has the Son has life. He that does not have the Son or possess the Son or indwelt by the Son does not have life. It's a terrible thing to be the walking dead. God wants to breathe life into you. Look out there at the world. Everybody's high on each other and themselves. They're the walking dead. That's why they like that program. I couldn't even stand watching a commercial about that. I couldn't even stand looking at the image of that thing, which is voodooism. Really? It's the worst kind, the deepest, darkest types of witchcraft involved in that, because there, it happens where demon spirits come in and possess a body that has already been deprived of its spirit. It's gone. The spirit is gone. That person is dead. Demon spirits come in and give that being, that body, life. It happens. It happens. It's a deep, terrible, dark witchcraft. And people delight in this darkness. They love darkness because their deeds are evil. People, it's time that you and I move into a relationship, a praise and a worship that begins to display the exploits of Almighty God through our life, to where all of a sudden we begin to see that his will is written upon our heart, that we're living epistles of God, written of God, living epistles written of God and read of men, where they're seeing heaven being displayed through our life because we know who is in us. We possess him. He possesses us. We've had that day. We know that the Father is in Christ Jesus and Christ Jesus is in us. Somebody tells me, oh, they tell me, oh, you know, there's only one. There's not three in the, in the Godhead, there's only one. I said, well, yeah, listen, you don't understand. There's three in the Godhead and I'm one with them. And then they're looking at me like going. But the others, and I said to some people the other day, I said, he that denies the Father and the Son is a liar, and it's the spirit of Antichrist. Is that in the Bible? Yeah, 1 John 2:22. Ruh-roh. And then we had to take another step and we say, and I'm one with him. I'm one with him. And that's how they're one with each other. Just like I'm one with them. John chapter 17 and verse 22. Hallelujah. John 17, verse 22. Wow. Then you back up and you look at 1 John chapter 3 and verse 24. Look at this with me. Look at 1 John 3:24. I want you to know that he's in you, that you're in him. Haven't been born again. Ha. Romosan. Haven't been made a new creation. Orama se to okia. Amazing, huh? You don't even fear. You don't need to fear ever again. Why be involved in one? All the other people that are demon possessed, who possess the devil, and the devil possesses them. Why would you want to be involved in what they're involved in? When you and I get to walk around in the halls of glory and the opulent beauty of God's house, decked with gold. No spooky house. It's decked with gold. Trimmed with gold. Huh? Its walls are of marble. Ha ha brosifit la mohompatani. Ha ha halabusavriti. Ha of sapphire stone. Ekis librusima. Ha resita lefitwa. Ha morishipa. Oh, think of the beautiful thing that God created when he created us in himself. If any man be in Christ, I'm in him. If Christ be in you. Huh? Think about this. If Christ be in you, Christ is in you. Your confidence of glory, my confidence that I will express that which turned the that same display of heaven that turned the water into wine, that raised the dead boy at Nain, that spoke the secrets of the heart to Nathaniel. He's here. He's in me. I'm not relying on me. You got to break ranks with you. You got to quit being so stuck on you. There's a transition where you go from, it's all about me. It's all about me. To being all about Him. Hallelujah. And you can't see you no more. And you don't even know. You don't even boast of you anymore. I can do. That's America. That's why they all love Trump. I'm going to write a book and it's going to be very successful. And everything is just continual narcissistic. There's this narcissistic world around us. And it's going to be great and I'm wonderful. And at home, they're sucking their thumb in fear and curled up in a fetal position, afraid to face the morning. But they get out there in the world around them and they're staring at themselves in the mirror and talking about how wonderful they are because they're so insecure. Humanity. Jesus. Praying for his salvation. It's just like, Lord, I mean, the biggest thing to me is I'm looking at the greater gulf and divide that is going to be created between the world and the Christian community because the Christian community stands with that. And it's going to create a greater gulf. Watch it. It's happening. The Lord already told me it was going to happen. At first I was a little shocked and I think, wait a minute, that actually needs to happen. That's a good idea. It's going to be a bad consequence for us all. Because we're going to be just that much more rank and filed to be nothing more than a bunch of prejudiced, bigoted, biased, narrow-minded, isolationists that want it all for ourselves and tell everybody else to go away. Because that's how it's all being painted and all framed up to be. It's time for the church to rise and have one champion, Christ Jesus, and to show forth one passion and one purpose. My goodness, I was telling people the other day, I was in a church, I promised, I didn't really fully promise. I just simply say, yeah, I'll try not to. So I said, don't say about anything political. And I got into that political situation. I said something political. I said, it is amazing to me how many evangelists there are for a president of the United States. I mean, if you guys could get that passion and that zeal turned to talking about Jesus, we'd see a revival take place in the city. I did not get that response right there. But praise God, I was protected by the anointing. I was captivated in the glory because all of those guys had taken the full, they had drunk the Kool-Aid for real. They drunk a gallon of it. I mean, there was some barrelers there, you know. They had the keg all to themselves. Oh, Lord Jesus. Lord Jesus, it's true. It's true. Come on, people. But Baba's setting this thing up so you and I are going to have some tough spots to live in. And I'm telling you right now, he's going to get us out of some tough spots too. He's going to get you and I into some serious trouble so he can show forth his mighty power through us. You might as well get excited about good trouble. Hallelujah. Just be sold out in the end because if you trust in yourself, it's going to look pretty ugly. Huh? Don't worry, I'll take care of you. I promise you. Don't worry, the men of faith take care of you. Huh? Because you don't even know how to grow a tomato. And if you did, it wouldn't be enough to satisfy your hunger. You know what I'm saying? Huh? Your fruit tree's going to go, you can't live off that. Huh? That's about all you can grow in Southern California is fruit trees. Huh? You're eating for 1 week. That's going to not be a pretty thing. Now, come on, people, it's time for us to step into the supernatural. Come on. It's time for us to step into this place that comes as an overflow and a consequence of just being so in love with Him, just being so captivated. Hallelujah. You know what? I don't need nothing else. I got Him. I don't need nothing else. He's asking for me to give Him a drink. And then He supplied for me the wellspring so that He could drink. Hallelujah. He's asking the same for from you because there's a river that will make glad the city of God that can be expressed to you in worship and praise. Hallelujah. Well, the rest just naturally happens. That's where faith gets strong and develops, because everything that you're ever going to do in God, central to it is going to be faith. 1 John chapter 3, verse 24, we read, "And he that keeps his commandments dwells in him." He that keeps his commandments dwells in God, and God dwells in him.
Amen.
Wow. Wow. Amazing. God is my possession. He lives and moves and walks in me. He's the one who inhabits my life. He's come to make his abode, Father, Holy Ghost, Lord Jesus Christ. Go to 1 John 4:13 real quick. 1 John 4:13, look at it. 1 John 4:13, "Hereby we know that we dwell in him and he dwells in us." Look at that. This oneness, I possess God, God possesses me. I'm in him, he's in me. I don't have to rely upon myself anymore. And I'm not going to boast of myself. Because once you start interacting with him, that don't work anymore. As soon as you do, start telling about what you can do, you violate something in the spirit and you know it. Before you have that encounter, when you've just been doing it, you're just still in the baby pool, you don't want to advance because you're afraid to get in up in the water up above your head. Huh? And the baby pool, you don't know any difference. You're just all sitting there bragging about how you can swim. You should have been here the other day. I actually jumped in. You didn't tell about the fact that you had somebody come to save your life, but nonetheless, you... Are you listening to me? You understand what I'm trying to tell you? But you start moving with him. You start relying upon him and it becomes all about him. You start boasting in yourself. You feel a spiritual violation that causes, you know, a reverberation through your whole being. You know, a sense of being overwhelmed that you just did something seriously bad wrong. You fall to your knees. Go, "Oh God, forgive me. I'll never do that again." Because when you step into this relationship Father wants you to have, you won't even want to utter anything about what you can do, because it's no longer you that lives. It's now a relationship where he alone lives. You're consumed by the fire of his presence, consumed by the very life of his own person. Of yourself, you can do nothing, and that's everywhere, in every dimension. You're relying upon God because all you're doing is living a supernatural life. We left one night here, and I was driving about 80 miles an hour, something like that. It was a meeting. It wasn't here at this building. It was a meeting. And I was drunk in the Holy Ghost. And I was going 80, 85, something like that. And the police are behind me. And I don't know it. I'm just driving. They're behind me. A long time they're behind me. Because they tell me, "We've been following you a long time. Do you ever look in your rear mirror?" Finally, he pulled up beside me and like waved. And I'm like, I pull over, and the guy comes out to the window, and the first thing he says is, "You're an excellent driver." Hey, I'm in the Holy Ghost. I'm telling you, I just caught away in the glory. "You're an excellent driver, but you need to look in your rearview mirror, and you need to slow down." I said, "Yes, sir." And he went back to his car. I didn't even get a chance to say, "I'm not drunk as you suppose." I was driving extra. I didn't even know why. I wasn't even driving. I was gone. I was gone with the wind of the Holy Ghost. That's what he said, eh? I got a bunch of witnesses. All you guys were in the car. Hallelujah. See, Tarabas Kinala. Who Mamananeya. Who Ramamana Setalo. I want you to step out of yourself and into him. It's already happened, but you're not willing to agree with it yet. You're not willing to say amen to it yet. You've not been willing to. You've been willing. You're excited about God to an extent of what you know and your encounter. But oh, I'm going to tell you, when you see him and what he's done for you, you don't want to live your own life anymore because his life is so much better than your life. Whoa. You're like, I'm not dealing with that life. No way. I don't want me no more. I want you to step into the halls of glory, says the Lord. I want you to step into the greatness of the expressions of my life through you, says God. This was the tongue that I was speaking a little bit ago. At the beginning of the meeting, I got very, very loud. And the Lord said, just give it later. Just give the interpretation later. And this is the Lord saying, beckoning us to come and allow him to live, to have a confidence and a boldness of the one who lives on the inside of us, of his glory, that he's purposed that would be issued forth from us and manifest through us, and not just in little kind of neat little casual every once in a while ways, but in explosions of dynamis, dynamite, supernuclear explosions. Gushing mighty rivers of life expressions. Whew. Nothing is like worship. If you don't know how to worship, if your heart's not yet been captivated when you stand there singing, if you're not standing there before the throne, if you're trying to get to the throne, something needs to be worked out in your relationship. Somewhere you didn't take the measure of faith and profit from it. You've not been faithful to it. You did not understand. Somehow you were spoiled. Somehow you were distracted. God wants to get you on the path of life. He wants to captivate you. He wants to rapture you away. Hallelujah. Where we quit singing, you're still there. Let the sun shine. No more cloudy days. Let the sun shine in the brightness of a new day. You're still going. I'm living and dwelling in Jesus. You hear me? You're not singing anymore. Now you're worshiping. You're not performing anymore. You're not participating like a good citizen. Are you listening to me?
Yes.
You're allowing that which Father is seeking for to flow through your life by the gift that he gave when he came to indwell on the inside of you. It's getting hot in here. Oh, yeah. You start wiggling around here in a few minutes. Oh, Papa wants to set you free. He wants to liberate you. He wants to captivate you. He wants to grow you up. He wants to give you some spiritual miracle grow. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Ha. Hallelujah. Ha. Hallelujah. He wants to take a little old seedling and turn it into the growth of a 2,000-year-old redwood, standing taller and bigger and more majestic than any of the trees of the field, to stand there and give him praise. He wants to light you up like the stars of the sky. Hallelujah. 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 It's time God's people start being full of the Holy Ghost so that the devil's people who are full of demon spirits might see a contrast. It's time for the miracle power and the display of heaven to scare all hell that dominates people's lives. It's time for heaven to stand up, and hell will flee away. Come on. The Lord Jesus said we will be hated by all nations. He said we will be hated by everyone. Not only said all nations, he also said everyone. I'm not sure if it's Matthew that says all nations and Luke says everyone. I think it's that way. It could be reverse. Lord Jesus, touch her. Touch the Holy Ghost woman. She's got her bonnet on tonight. I was some old woman, man, I tell you. It was a pretty sad situation. She got her bonnet on so she won't tempt the angels. Nobody. Oh, the crazy religious things that people believe. This is crazy. All the time they could have the glory and the power of God, and they're arguing over what day to worship Jesus, whether they should have a bonnet on so they don't tempt the angels or not. What? Jesus. Jesus and all. And all the other religious things that are going down in Pentecostals' lives. Oh, come on, man. You got God. I said, you got God. I said, you got God. You got God in a way that Enoch did not have. I said, you got God in a way that Joseph did not have. You got God in a way that Moses did not have. You got God. You got God on a way that the prophets of old looked and saw this day and desired to be a part of it. You got God. Grab a hold of him. Begin to worship. Look at Rivala Sita Ramas. Mataya Punasaya Pahaya. Get yourself happy and stay happy. You got a measure of faith to get yourself happy and stay happy, and if you'll be faithful of it, with it, you got a measure of faith to stick and get in love and stay in love. And if you'll dwell in love, I'm telling you, the explosions of God are in your life and through your life. Woo! Habra Sarahayo. Nintendo Bosaneha. Oh, my. I'm going to say, no sinner on the earth is going to have a more wonderful and exciting and fun, thrilled day than I'm going to have tomorrow. Ain't no way. They can't even touch. They can't get near where I'm at. They can't get near where the saints of God stand. It's time, people, that there begin to be an expression of the abundant life. The love-filled life, joy-filled life, God-filled life, spirit-filled life, glory-filled life, heaven-filled life. This is the overcoming power that overcomes the world. This is why the Lord says, the more than conquerors through Christ who strengthens us. Oh, and that's in the midst of great adversity. That is in the great midst of great upheaval and persecution. I mean, Paul did all he did all the time. God allowed an angel, not a demon spirit, not a bunch of temptation, not a bunch of just normal, everyday, atmospheric things, but literally an angel was allowed to stand before him and threaten him and beat him up to buffet him. And he said, Lord, take it. Don't allow this angel to do this to me anymore. He says, no, I'm not going to take it away. You're going to deal with it. In the midst of that, he said, I'm exceeding glad. I'll rejoice in all my tribulation. He's the one who wrote the life in Revelation. All life is rejoice evermore. In all things, give thanks, for this is the will of God concerning you in Christ Jesus. He's saying, learn how to worship. He's saying, learn how to praise. He's saying, learn how to joy. He's saying, learn how to walk. Without this walk of fellowship. Hallelujah. Mara say, just do it. Do it. Every time your giant of you comes along and threatens you with all of its fear tactics and all who you are and who you like to be and who you wish you were, and somehow you often doubt and unbelief and fear and torment, run to worship. When your heart is overwhelmed, God will lead you to the rock. He will tell you, as he said to Cain, there's an offering that lies at your door, offer it. But you can be all upset and be downcast. That means you got to frown.
I was watching A.A. Allen one night, and he was ministering to a person who was demon-possessed. And he turned the woman around, and she looked like an everyday, ordinary Pentecostal Christian. And he said, look at this depression upon her face. Look at the power of the demonic spirits in her life. And I'm thinking, maybe I ought to try to get everybody watching this. Because then they were like, wait a minute. Have I been looking like that lately? I'm not having no devils. No, there's no reason. There's no reason to be downcast. And I just want to read this couple more verses of Scripture. Verse 15, whosoever shall confess that Jesus is the Son of God. Look how easy it is. God dwells in him and he dwells in God. Whew. Look at this. And we know and believe the love that God has to us. God is love. He that dwells in love dwells in God, and God in him. Look at it. Just keeps repeating it. See that? I've got a oneness. I've got a possession. I've got an inheritance. It's not me that lives. You're not going to have this until your tongue becomes as a pen of a ready writer. Until your tongue becomes the quill of God. And all you speak is what he said. And that ink, that means by which you speak it, isn't just some kind of mental assent, but it's a living reality of a living word, a powerful living word that you were born by, that you were begotten by, that works effectually within you, and the Spirit expresses it through you. And there God writes the pages of his will in your life, in your heart, in your expression, in your deeds, in your conduct. Now it's no longer about you. You don't even exist anymore. I was in a meeting not too long ago in the South, and there was just a mighty thunderous presence of God. It was a wonderful thing. I'm always amazed at the Lord. Because, I got there just tired and weary. And as soon as I got out of the car, I stepped into a glory cloud of heaven. A mantle came upon me. This glorious presence of the Lord. And after the meeting was over and things were starting to settle down, because Father just had a, there was just an outbreak of heaven. People weren't used to being around the things of the Spirit. And they had no ability to resist, kind of thing, you know. Hallelujah. Someone said, I said, do you know who I am? I said, I'm not sure that I know who you are. They said, well, I'm so-and-so. I'm the person who used to always straighten you out when you would come around. I said, that person's dead. She looked at me and she said, I know, I can see that. Has that person ever become dead to you? The person that you were before God possessed you, before you became a new creation, and God took over your life. Is that person dead, or is that person still exist? Do you still have confidence in the flesh? Do you still have confidence in your own thinking, in your own understanding, in your own ability to figure things out and do stuff? Then you can't have what he has for you. You can only just have a little bit. He stands begging on the door of your heart, and he's saying, would you please open up and let me come in and let me show you that I got a life better for you than the one you've been living. I'll create something in you that you won't boast in yourself anymore. You'll be ashamed. You'll boast rather in me. Amen. You'll rather live my life. You think about Father said, listen, I'm just giving you the wealth and the riches of all heaven. And you're still holding on to that which he calls a filthy rag. Huh? Which he says, no flesh shall glory in my presence. There shall be no boasting of men before my face. I can hear heaven. I can hear heaven. I hear Jesus calling you. You can try all of your lifetime to walk with God. You're never going to be able to do it until you'll step into the life that God has given you and begin to worship him, begin to be excited about his goodness, about his love. Start living and dwelling in the love. He that dwells in love. There is no fear in love. Hallelujah. Father wants to get you in a place where there is no fear. Hallelujah. And that just comes down to the place of you and I just accepting who he is. Saying, and we accept who he is by just speaking it, declaring it. His word produces faith. Hallelujah. That agreement with God is the first definition of belief. It's amin. It's what, and it was counted unto Abraham for righteousness because he amined God. He said amen to God. And that's what it was translated, believe. He just agreed with God. He said yes to God. He said, Lord, I trust you. I trust you as my life. God did not give Abraham the opportunity he's given you tonight. I want everybody to stand with me. God did not give Abraham the opportunity. Come on, musicians, don't lag 5 minutes behind. Time to strike. You know, the Lord showed me tonight that the arrows would hit their mark. I pray in the name of Jesus that every one of you will respond. God hit his target tonight. The arrows found their mark. The Lord's a good shot. It's a good shot. Will you just start worshiping him? Will you just start delighting in the Lord? Will you just start agreeing with God and just be in awe of the fact that he's in you and you're in him? Could you stop for 5 minutes feeling bad about yourself? And when you no longer live, it's not even a problem. Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Come on. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Come, Lord Jesus. Come, Lord Jesus. And manifest yourself to every person in this place. There are people in this place tonight, you listen to me. Some of you came because someone drug you in here. Some of you came because your mama made you do it. Come play. Thank you, Jesus. Just play more of Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, living God. You listen to me now. The strongholds of hell will destroy you. You listen to me. If you're fascinated with the world, you are fascinated with death. And death will destroy you forever. The power of the occult and the working of witchcraft and demon spirits will only get worse. And that's all you're playing around with right now. You can call it this thing and you can call it that thing and you put little tags on it and you put little dresses on it, little pants on it, and you dress it up any way you want to. It's nothing more than the power of witchcraft and sorcery, power of hell, power of death. And death is a formidable foe. And every person in this place tonight, you will face death. Every one of you. Some of you will face death with the light and life of Jesus Christ, and you're good, because death has no power. It's lost its sting. With the light and life of Jesus Christ, when death comes to me, light and effulgency of bright noonday shining glory on the face of God, light will bust forth before death. The same one who raised Jesus from the dead lives in me.
God will not make you serve him. If you want to play games with lust and filth and the demonic realm, you may. But you're missing out on every good thing. You're missing out on life. You're missing out on something that you could have been throughout the ages, not only now, but throughout the ages, that goes beyond description. To begin, and I'm talking really especially to two people in this place. Because you begin to create a pattern in your life. You're young. And you begin to create a pattern in your life of perpetual backsliding. You get touched by the power of God, and then you go back. You touch the realms of the Spirit of the Lord. Then you go back to iniquity and darkness, like a dog returning to its vomit. Lick, lick. You're creating for your life a pattern. I believe that perpetual backsliding is cousin to the blasphemy of the Holy Ghost. I've never really seen perpetual backsliders take a hold of God. I've never seen it. More than likely, perpetual backsliders will be lost forever. And here you are, very young, and you're setting and creating for you a condition, a spiritual disease that will only worsen and grow stronger with time. I feel so sorry for you. I feel so sorry for you. You're listening to the one who hates you and rejecting the one who loves you. You're running to the one who despises you, who will destroy your soul forever in hell, who will set you up for one heartbreak and one disastrous situation to the next, to the place where you will ultimately commit suicide and take your own life. All the time you had one pleading with you, telling you his love, his deeper love and affections for you, but that wasn't good enough for you. You needed the lust of the flesh and the lust of the eye, and you needed the praises of men, and you needed an affection that would one day love you and the next day hate you. Just to use you and abuse you and throw you away like the wrapping of a hamburger once it's eaten. True. You better flee from the wrath that is to come, because wrath is building up against the day of judgment. And fiery indignation from the Lord. He loves you, but you're not going to play games with him. God has granted to all men this ability to escape damnation, to escape sin and iniquity and fear and bondage and all the stuff that the world is imprisoned by. Let me tell you something. Let me give you a clue. You will not find one righteous man in the ranks of this of darkness. You will not find one person who has true love in their life in the ranks of sinners. You will not find one person who's really honest and true. You won't. They belong in the kingdom of God. That's it. That's where in the place where they are. Why would you let Satan lie to you? Father gives you an opportunity. That is better. I'll take Jesus and be poor and be happy the whole time. Because I don't need anything else. I have him. I got the grand prize. So the Lord's looking at you tonight and he's dancing around. And as he said in Zephaniah 3:17, he's rejoicing over you. And he's saying, I'm your prize. I'm your prize. I'm your prize. And you're looking at him and saying, you know, I got other fish to fry. I got other things to do. I got other things that's captivated me. Or maybe you don't even see it. Maybe you've been blinded by the God of this world and you don't even see it. Jesus. Jesus. Lord Jesus. I pray tonight that every person sitting in this place, you will have an encounter with Jesus Christ. And you'll no longer live. And when we interview you and ask you about you, you won't go to bragging on yourself. Telling us how well you can do and how great of a job you can do. Give me a break. The Christian community. Jesus. Oh God. But you'll have an encounter where that you'll say, like the Apostle Paul, yeah, I had all this, I did this and I did that, but it's dung to me. It's what you flush down the toilet. Anybody sit there and stare at it? I'm going to get it gross for a minute because look, it just, that's really what it is. It's what it is. I mean, I praise God for toilets every time I go to one. I just think, I praise God. I say, thank you, Father, for toilets. Our ancestors that had to live with outhouses, poor them. Those places are stinky, nasty, gross, hard, wooden, splinters in your bottom. Thank you, Lord, for toilets. That these things may be removed from our sight. Removed from our sight. And our smell. Hallelujah. Listen, I'm getting graphic because I'm telling you how Paul felt about his own ability and his own life after having encountered this wonderful glory of God being his possession. Hear me. Hear me tonight. Hear me tonight. You received a measure of faith. It needs to be developed. You received the word of life. It needs to be hearkened unto. Because I'm telling you, God alone, he himself retains all right to revelation. And you seek him, and you go and discover some stuff. He looks at your heart and he says, are you ready? Are you ready? Are you ready for me to come to you? You ready? You ready? You ready for me to reveal myself to you? Every day I've got a growing revelation of Jesus. Do you? Do you? Do you have a growing revelation of Jesus? Every day. Every day. I'm trembling. I'm trembling in expectation. I thought he was moving around in my room last night. Of course he was, but I mean, I thought I could see him. It's going to happen. It's going to materialize. Everybody I know that actually saw him, seen him physically. There's people that literally sit down and talk to Jesus. When I hear that, I don't sit there go, well, I really doubt. I don't think that happened. Well, it doesn't seem to line up, blah, blah, blah. I'm like captivated. You did what? You talked to Jesus. I don't have that demonic realm working in my life. The demonic realm of suspicion doesn't work with me. I'm over here in heaven. Just think tonight. God's not leaving you out, nobody here. He wants to come manifest himself to you. Jesus. Jesus. Come on. Go to heaven. Go up in heaven. Go up in heaven. Just go up in heaven. Just go up in heaven. Go up in heaven. Go up in heaven. There's a sound going on in heaven. There's a sound. What you don't understand is there's a sound going on in heaven.
I know what happens, people. I understand. We get so captivated by all the stuff that we got to do. We're burdened with this. We're burdened with that. We got this obligation, that obligation, this responsibility, that responsibility. The load is on us. You know, we got to make all this money to keep up with all these things. And we got all these pressures and all these performance-based things. Would you just let that go tonight? You just let that go tonight. God will do a lot better job through you when you're not working so hard. Tonight, Jesus stands at the door of your heart. He's knocking. He's calling you. He's pleading with you. Open the door and let him in. Will you let him in? Tonight, the Spirit of the Lord is calling you. He wants to deliver you. He wants to deliver you from the torment of hell. Will you let him touch you? Will you let him deliver you? He will not transgress your will. But if you begin to yield yourself to him, he'll write the pages of his will upon your life. You'll be a manifest person, a person manifesting the will of God. He'll write the pages of his life. You'll reveal his life. Whew. Jesus. Jesus. I want to invite everybody to come tonight, which is everybody just come. I want you to come here tonight. I want you to stand proxy for somebody who's lost. Some of you just need to come just stand before God saying, Lord, here I am. Let him touch you. Let Jesus touch you now. Let revival begin in your life. God made Adam a living being. Jesus is a reviving spirit. Let him revive you right now. Just learn to worship him. Learn to worship him. Learn to worship him. Stop complaining. Stop praying the prayers of doubt and unbelief. Stop hoping for a day. Stop wishing some way, somehow. And start thanking him for all that he's done. That's right. You just begin to agree with God and you're going to get yourself a smile. You start agreeing with God. You start going, wow, really? You're in me and I'm in you? You stand there and feel bad about yourself for being a goof if you want. Or you're going to say, man, I'm going to start doing it right. Come on. Come on, man. Mama, my God, lay hold on God. Lay hold on eternal life. Handle him. See him. See him. Look upon him. Gaze on him. Hear him. Lay hold. Lay hold. Lay hold. Lay hold. Lay hold. Thank you. You do not have to talk God into this.
You do not have to talk God into this. You need to agree with Him. He wants you to believe what He said, what He's spoken. Tonight, just accept the life, the eternal life, the abundant life. Make a transition. Some of you don't know the life. When you listen, you've been born again. The majority of everybody in this place, you've been born again, but you've never really stepped in to participate in enjoying the abundant life. You've lived the life of a man in the presence of the Lord. You lived in the realm of trusting in the arm of flesh and human ability when God wanted you to take that step over into the realms of glory and begin to let Him live and live by the Holy Ghost, by the Spirit. And I'm telling you, that's happy land. It's like Michaela said, all I need to do to go out and evangelize in Klamath Falls is walk around with a smile. Because everybody says, what's wrong with you? What's happening? Why are you smiling? Because it's a strange thing. And it's not just Klamath Falls. It's right here. It's in your workplace tomorrow. Because many of you are going to go into your workplace and you're going to look worse than you do when you come into the church place. Because this is your best. And some of you are looking pretty bad. Looking pretty sad. I don't see God. I just have to see by faith. I have to believe those things, you know, that are hoped for. How much worse is it is for the lost? I don't see a difference. But if you'll step into life, people are going to look at you and they're going to go, hey, what happened to you? Did you fall in love? Because that's the only way they can express it. Are you in love? It's like your face is shining. You know, even the lost, right? They don't know Jesus, but they just fell in love. And they got all happy. They got like a little shine. Because love, even that human love, produces shine on you. Produce a glorious appearance. What happens? When you begin to agree with God's word, and you begin to allow the Holy Spirit to come and pour the love of God into your heart, to cause you to experience the freedom, to cause you to experience acceptance in the Beloved, to no longer have condemnation and shame and fear, to no longer feel isolated and wonder why, what's wrong with you. Well, you just begin to worship because God said you are, so you know you are, and you don't need any additional proofs. I mean, you're good to go because God's made you whole. Oh, what glory divine. Oh, what blessed glory divine. Now, I must be honest with you. I want you to hear something. I witnessed people that don't know a fraction of the Word of God. They still got a lot of stumblings and things going on in their life that they don't even really understand is wrong. But they became so certain of the love of God and forgiveness that they lit up with the presence of the Lord more than people that sit around in church for years, know all kinds of Bible information, all kinds of knowledge, and that those people cannot hold a candle to the light that is going on. And those people who've fallen in love, there's no more guilt, there's no more shame, there's no more condemnation, there's no more isolation, there's no distance. Quit trying to be somebody and start living His life. If you possess the Son, if you're indwelt by Him, if He's in you, you no longer live. When you possess the Son, you're good. You're good. You shouldn't want anything else. You're not undone. You shouldn't need anything. You don't need a bunch of additionals. And when you do, you can never have them. But when you begin to delight yourself in Him and He's all you want, you get the rest. Because when you delight yourself in Him and He's all you want, then now He's free to be expressed through you. There's a flow because there's a yieldedness. There's no longer a competition between you and Him. You're not trying to do it by the arm of flesh because the Lord despises it. He despises it. Once again, Paul said, you need something else to be right with God? You still don't feel complete? Well, then you've fallen from grace. That's what he said. He said, you've made grace, you've made faith void. It's none effect in your life. That's what he said. All they were doing was saying, well, we also need to go ahead and get circumcised because it's good and it's right and we can feel complete and part of the community. We won't feel like outsiders. We're really belonging. You know, we're really a part of what everybody else is doing. He says, no. And you're falling from grace. You made it void. It had no effect. It's been voided out. There are too many people who come stand in His presence and they feel like they need something else. You need to worship. You need to get happy about the package. And it's all found in Jesus. Can you have Him? God dwells in you. I didn't read half the verses of Scripture tonight. I didn't read a tenth of the verses of Scriptures tonight. To specifically address one one-hundredth of the verses of Scripture tonight to specifically address you being in God and God being in you. If that's not enough, I don't know what to do for you. God doesn't know what to do for you. God is not enough. I tell you, He's more than enough. You just got to agree with Him. Jesus. It's really the most important thing, especially for people in the culture of the West. I don't do things in the kingdom of God for the Lord because I have to. I'm not all frustrated and wound up about it and tied up about it and trying to figure it all out. It's an overflow. I don't want anything else, and I don't need anything else but Him. And I just want you to know, I got the right salvation. I got it. I got what the Bible describes.
And we're just inviting you to come in. Because you come in here, you're going to have an encounter with God, and then you're going to be empowered to do something. Jesus. Jesus. Just lift your hands towards heaven. Jesus. Jesus. Just say with me, say, Lord.
Lord.
I love you. Can you say it like a little more tenderly, with a little bit more affection? Instead of you're hollering at him. Say, Lord, I love you. Try it again. Try that one more time. Say, Lord, I love you. If you'll just keep doing that, you're going to hear him say, hey, I love you too. I promise you. This is worship. Start doing this. If you start getting thankful, just get thankful over your pillow, your bed, your car, whatever it is you have to drive, the clothes that you have to wear. But more than all of those things, the Lord's looking at you going and said, do you love me more than these? Because he just wants to be loved. He's like jumping around going, I'm your prize. And everybody's like looking around, well, what else? And then somebody sees him saying, I'm your prize. And you go, really? That is, you are? You're all I want. That's where it begins. You don't need anything else. The Lord's jumping around saying, I'm your prize. And then people are saying, but what about this? And what about that? And what about the other thing? And I need this and I need that. And besides that, you don't know what it's like to live with my spouse. And really it is, when you say that, it's really, you don't know what it's like to live with you. The accuser is always the demon. Do you understand that?
Yeah.
Good. Get a spirit knowledge. Spirit knowledge came to us from the Word. The accuser is always the demon. Yeah. Serpent. The devil. The accuser of the brethren. But just let your hands there over there. Just love him. Just say, Lord, I love you. Could you say it with a smile? I got this little puppy. Smartest puppy I've ever had in my life. When I got home tonight, he's going to go into a fit of convulsions over seeing me. I mean, it's like it is even impossible for the body to do those kinds of contortions. It's just so excited to see me. Papa, that's what I look like right with you. That's what I look like right. That's what I look like right. My dog can't show me more love than I can show you right. I don't want to be outdone by a puppy dog, Lord. Right? 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 You got to let faith that you've been given to worship develop and mature and grow. And you're only going to grow because you dwell in it and you do it and you give yourself to it and you'll be perfected in it. It will develop. If you allow yourself to go and do the opposite, it is going to run ruin. I will not be outdone by a puppy dog. I wish I could dance like he dances. I mean, it's a dance. You know what I'm saying, right? The little puppy dog dance. It's just crazy. Every part of his body's moving. His feet are moving. His little toes are moving. His tongue's moving. His head's moving. His body's doing all kinds of contortions. He's so glad to see me. Hey, come on. Don't be outdone by a puppy dog. I dare say this. I would never do this. But I dare say that if I mistreated that dog, he would still have the same behavior towards me. There's some kind of expression there that it's like, I've always looked at that and said, wait a minute. The Lord is saying something here. But I do that with everything. I do that with the sun coming up in the morning. To me, his voice fills the whole world. His voice fills every dimension of life. Hear him. Can you hear him? Can you hear the song? Can you hear the stars singing together? Can you hear the choir of heaven? If you'll start worshiping, you'll go to bed at night hearing the angels sing. Literally hear the angels sing. I'd love to get everybody here on the School of Worship and get them to worship until they cannot stop. See, that's the breakthrough. And maybe we need to make some meetings more about that. It's just, I get really disappointed when I see people, they're not even close to the breakthrough and they're already sitting down. They're already distracted. They had enough energy to go for two songs. I used to hear all the old preachers say, oh, don't wear the people out before we start ministering. Don't wear them out with worship. Never made any sense to me. Wear them out with worship? Shouldn't that refresh them? I never understood that. And I praise God that I never understood that. I promise you, you'll break through in worship. Your body will be refreshed. Disease won't be allowed to take a hold of you. Joy will reign in you. Do not yield your members to sorrow and sadness anymore. Don't yield your members. Don't yield your members to disappointment and fear anymore. God sent forth the Spirit of His Son into your heart, crying, Abba, Father. He delivered you from the fear. That creates the torment. That creates the unworthiness, the offense. Let me say this. This is important for me to say this. All I have to do is lift my hands towards heaven. And I'm overwhelmed by his presence. I don't have to say anything. I promise you, that's what Father has for you. No matter where you're at, what situation or condition you find yourself in, I could just lift your hands towards heaven. And the glory of God will come upon you. The anointing of heaven begin to overwhelm you. And then when you start saying stuff like, Father, thank you that you're my dad. Thank you, Lord Jesus, that you live in me, that you filled me with your life. Oh, then the glory really starts flowing. Because when you start agreeing with God, my. The world is waiting. God is waiting, first and foremost. The world is waiting to see those who will begin to walk as the sons of God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Find a bunch of people around you right now. Hug them. Tell them that you love them. Bless them in Jesus' name. Just tell them, walk with God. Tell them, walk with God. Say, walk with God.